Well, good evening. Hello to everybody here. Hello to everybody watching online tonight. We're so excited that you've joined us again for another exciting night of Let's Show the Truth. And let's learn when we've been told fiction and what lies look like and the difference. And tonight's really going to be an exciting night because our president of Creation Truth Foundation, Matt Miles, is with us again. And tonight he's going to be talking about the subject of evolution, human evolution specifically, and how the evidence that has been presented for that is totally, it's a lie. And he's going to show you things that you've probably never heard before. And this stuff is really going to get you interested. When I first learned some of these things that they don't tell you in the museums, the stories behind what they're showing in the museums, it's pretty astounding. And we've been sold a crock of poo in our public school systems and in our colleges. And so the good news is tonight you're going to get to see the other side, and you're going to get to see that what God said he did in his word, the scripture, is exactly what he did. So with all that said, I'm just going to hand you right over. Would you please welcome with me, Mr. Matt Miles?
Golly, that introduction's killing me, bro.
You can do this. I'm getting you excited, bro.
I'm excited. I am again thankful to be here. Everybody had a decent day? Everybody had a decent day? Had a good day myself. Didn't get a nap today. So I'm with everybody else in here that didn't get a nap. And we'll see how it goes tonight. I often say how long I think I'm going to go, and then I lie, and so I'm just not going to say anything. Tonight, again, my passion, my desire for you in this place will be to have your worldview quite possibly a little more transformed and closer to his will. That's my desire, my goal. Tonight's topic is a topic that is very, very important because of what Jeff said. There are many, many of us that have been evolutionized with things that we've seen or heard that has come across to us as factual. And if we didn't take the time at the moment that we heard them to go study and see what was actually found, they may still be rattling around in here in the back. And they come out every once in a while. They show their ugly little head and they come out. And then they put doubt on how we see this book. I mean, I can't tell you the number of folks that I come across that go, but, okay, example. 2 weeks ago, I'm in Indiana. And after I'm not even teaching on this topic. A young lady comes up to the table in her 20s and says, okay, I'm a Christian. Sweet. Okay. She goes, and I don't believe in evolution. Like, sweet. And she says, but we start into this conversation about dinosaurs evolving into birds. She's already prefaced, she doesn't believe in evolution, but she's giving me the quintessential dinosaurs have evolved into birds. Evolutionary worldview. I went, well, it's not how I see it. And she made a comment about cavemen. And I said, oh, hang on. Stop. Tell me how you see Adam and Eve for a second. I said, who is Adam and Eve? Well, it's just the first two people. I said, Tell me your perception of them. What's in your worldview about what they look like? How did they act? What was their behavior? She said, well, people. And da-da-da-da. I said, okay. So if they were like us, where's cavemen come in? I said, what if Adam and Eve were like us, and they're the first two, and you're accepting that. Well, no, it would be all the people before, and you could see the wheels go. I could see it in her. She'd been evolutionized, and she didn't even realize it, didn't catch it, till that moment when I just made her think about Adam and Eve differently. I think we all have that. Next year, when I come back with dinosaurs, I'm going to have a replica of a set of footprints up here. A dinosaur stepping across a human footprint. A dinosaur footprint stepped across a human footprint. I can't tell you the number of kids that I've showed that to, and the kids, immediately, their response is what? Well, that's a caveman footprint. Why? Because we've all been evolutionized with cartoons like the Croods. Good Dinosaur, where we humans were more animal-like than the dinosaurs were. Hello? Go back and watch that movie again. Once your worldview has been impacted. See, I can't watch that stuff anymore. And just, I try to have fun watching that stuff, and my worldview doesn't allow me to much any longer. Because what I'm seeing when I'm watching that is my brain is going, now I get to deal with this at camp next summer. Now I have to deal with this when I go teach students, see? And so my brain engages in, okay, now how am I going to deal with this? As much as they see a movie, they're compartmentalizing into their worldview things that are unbiblical, and they don't even realize it. We don't even realize it. So tonight's topic, I want to start off with where we were last night. Oh, hang on. Everybody's going to ask me later, and I'm going to forget. Okay, some books that deal with what we're talking about tonight. Guess where we're going to be tonight a little bit. Chapter 11, okay? So this is Bodie Hodge. Ken Ham, founder of Answers in Genesis out of Kentucky. He's the fellow with the Ark and the Creation Museum over in Kentucky. This is his son-in-law. Bodie Hodge wrote this great, great book, great treatise to Tower of Babel, okay? And then Ken Ham and Charles Ware wrote this phenomenal book talking about we are one race and one blood, period. Period. One of the best treatises to this idea of race that there is that I've ever read is this book right here. So they went back and they revised it and updated it like a year ago, It has been 3 years. Okay, so 3 years ago, they revised and updated it. Those are really good. So back to what, okay, check this out. Turn with me to Romans chapter 5 right quick. Before we get to Genesis, let's look at Romans chapter 5 for a second. As we begin talking about this topic tonight. Something that I did not cover heavily last night, we studied through 3 and we realized that one of the curses was that Adam and Eve, their days would become numbered. They were going to return to the dust. They were going to what, church? Die. Okay? So it didn't happen immediately. They were cast out of the garden. To protect them from being in their sinful nature, in their sinful non-eternal body, they were protected. They were shown grace. They were not allowed to go back into the garden where there was a very special tree that if they would have eaten, even at that point, what would they have done? Live forever if they got a hold of the tree of life, but forever in this shell. That someday we learn we get rid of. This body that is not better every year. Doesn't get better. Amen? Any amen? It doesn't get any better. It's my I mean, like right now, I pulled something in my neck this afternoon, right over here. Like, that never used to happen. Like, I'm just sitting in a chair, and all of a sudden, I'm like, oh, you know, I'm like, okay, it's not getting better, okay? We're not evolving and getting better. I mean, we need to understand that. There's nothing about what we can observe that says we're getting better. Every generation is not getting better. We are not getting better. We're getting worse. Okay? So on that, at that moment in the garden, as sin has entered the world and the Lord has put this curse of death on Adam and Eve, it wasn't just Adam and Eve. It was the entire creation at that moment gets cursed with death. Prior to that moment, there was no death of any blood-containing creature. The Word of God calls blood-containing creatures kaye nefesh creatures. They were things made on day 5 and day 6. Creatures, everything made on day 5 and day 6 are kaye nefesh creatures. They are living creatures. They have blood. Day 5 and day 6 life is different than day 3 life. What was day 3 life? Do you remember? The plants. Plants. Did somebody say plant? Okay, good. Plant. Plants. I'm deaf. See, I'm going deaf. This is not getting any better. Okay. So plants. See, plants are never called kaye nefesh life. So do you recall, a little rewind that we didn't cover either, do you recall in chapter 1 what everything that is kaye nefesh is given to eat when everything was perfect? All right, so before we go to Romans 5, go back to 1. Hang on. Back up. I need you with me here. Back to chapter 1, verse 29 and following says this. This is on day 6, right before he says everything is very good. He's just created us. And in verse 29, it says this. Then God said, I will give every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has fruit with seed in it, they will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth and all the birds of the air and all the creatures that move along the ground, that means from the biggest to the smallest, everything that has the breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food. And it was so. That's what T-Rex ate when he was first created. According to the Word of God, what did he eat? Plants. And that doesn't mean he was over-munching on a leaf. Was he equipped well enough to eat whole watermelon? Yeah, but see, and now am I stretching a worldview a little? Like, when was the last time we saw a T-Rex eating anything but meat? Hello? See, we don't even realize it, and we get fed stuff, and then we never think through what we get fed. Like, when was the last time we saw a T-Rex eat anything? Hello? See? And we just go see these great movies about these wonderful creatures that the Lord's made, and we're fed an evolutionary worldview, and we don't even realize it. Don't even realize it. Because if we have dinosaurs eating blood-containing creatures before sin, what are we going to have a problem with? What is that right over there? If death was already here on the planet before sin, so chapter 3 isn't when sin comes and death comes to earth, then why would Jesus have to physically die? Come on, church. See, we've got to connect dots. This is all truth. It all connects. It's all consistent. It's something that we are asked to put our lives on. And he's not going to do that with something that's going to lie to us. It makes no sense to go there. If you have death of blood-containing creatures before sin, why would Jesus have to give his life? He could have just done some spiritual, okay, everybody's good. Shake some water. I'm good. Okay. That's all I'm going to say about that. see, death came because, well, how do I know death came because of sin? Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. Verse 12. Very interesting passage. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way, death came to who? All men. Because what? We've all sinned. Did it say that death got here by a dinosaur 65 plus million years ago? Does it say that death got here because, well, a carnivorous animal was eating another animal and shedding that blood? Not what it says. So literally, in this book, in chapter 3 that we studied last night, what was the first thing to physically die in history? Come on. What animal? The one that was used to cover them. That is the first sign of death in all of history, according to this book. So look at verse, let's go back to Genesis chapter 3. Verse 20, I did not read last night because I knew we were going to cover it tonight. And I need it in your worldview. I need you to know it's there. One of those detailed verses that I think we've glossed over most of our lives. No, I did. And when I read it, I went, oh, well, that makes sense. It's one of those, well, duh. But it actually says it. I mean, there's like details in here. Look what it says. Adam names his wife what? Eve, it says, because she would become the mother of all the living, aka Adam and Eve were the first two people on the planet. They did not have belly buttons. Okay, well, that's where I ride. It doesn't. I wish I could give you a chapter and verse for that. I so wish. I can't, though. I really can't. That is part of my worldview. I'm on that side. It wouldn't have needed one. Hello? The only reason we have them is why? We're born of a woman, of a mom. We have a mom. That's why we have them. They didn't have a mom. Neither one of them did. So as we talk and as we begin this evening talking about this human evolution, really. See, there have been ideas out there. Ideas that, for the most of us, have a lot to do with this gentleman. Charles Darwin, in the early to middle 1800s, He is the one that most of us have put together with this idea of evolution, okay? And for whatever reason, because a lot of us, I find, we haven't really read through Origin of Species, which is like his go-to work for lots of folks, okay? We most of us don't know that he studied when he went to college for just a little bit before he dropped out. He studied to be a theologian. Most of us don't know that either. We think of Charles Darwin as this scientist. That was not what he went to school to study to be. He was going to be a pastor. That was his formal education. But he wasn't a good student, so he dropped out. And then this fella gets ready to make a voyage on the HMS Beagle. Fitzroy invites him to come along because he'd always had an interest in bugs and nature and stuff. He said, why don't you come along with us on this voyage around the world? And so he does. And he goes. And as they're going around and he's seeing all these things, what we don't often know unless you've studied his life is that as he's getting ready to go on this voyage, he gets this two-volume set of books about the geology of the planet Earth, the rocks, by a fellow by the name of Charles Lyell. Charles Lyell was him and about 20-some other guys at the same time period, early 1800s, was beginning to try to formulate an idea about the rocks that would give a history about the rocks that is different than what this book says about how we got all the rock layers on the planet by a worldwide covering what? Flood. That's what this one says. But Charles Lyell tries, his desire, his worldview was, we've got to figure out how to free science from Moses. And he said that in a letter, by the way. So that was his worldview. Whatever I can do in science to get everybody to go away from this in science, that's what his desire was, Charles Lyell. So he writes this two-volume set about all the rocks, about how they should be stacked up and they should be named and they should have fossils that identify the names of the rocks and then a date that's been arbitrarily attached to them. Let me say that again. Dates that have been arbitrarily attached to every layer. So that when you find a certain index fossil in a certain layer, well, how old is that? Well, it's got to be 520 million years old because it has a trilobite in it. Well, how do you know the trilobite's 520 million years old? Because we find it in a Cambrian layer of rock. The fossils are dated by the rock layers, and the rock layers are dated by the fossils. To this day, church, focus, to this day, it has not changed. From the early 1800s, that has not changed. So he goes on this voyage, HMS Beagle. He has this series of books with him that he's studying. So what's being fed into his worldview about how old the Earth is? Hundreds of millions of years old. As he's seeing all these creatures, and he gets to the Galapagos Islands, and he sees all these creatures that he's never seen before that are totally weird for everything else that's on the planet that he's seeing. And he's like, well, I got an idea. And so he writes in his journal, one of his note pages. It shows this tree. This tree. Guys, it gets nicknamed the Tree of Life, by the way. Wow. If you Google the Tree of Life in Google, you'll get Darwin's tree in his journal, this little sketch. Wow. Whew. Yeah. That brings to mind another passage in I'll leave that for Jeff next week as he starts a new series. I'll leave that for Jeff. Romans chapter 1. Right, brother? Okay. So here's what he's got, this idea that maybe at some point everything started here in this thing and then everything branches off of each other into all of our different little organisms. Okay. And look what he even wrote right here. He didn't even say, I know. This is an idea. There was an idea. He proposes an idea. He's very open to say, even in his book, that, you know what, there may be something that comes along down the pipe that says that this is not going to work out. Guess what? We've got lots of stuff to say that this doesn't work out, but that doesn't stop some. And stop our museums. Listen to me. Doesn't stop our school textbooks. Doesn't. Beautiful colored wall in the Field Museum in Chicago. It's like, anybody ever been to the Field Museum? Chicago? From a natural history specimen point of view, wonderful museum. Wow, some of the stuff they got is phenomenal. Some of their dinosaurs are just out. They're awesome. They're cool. But you have to put up with this. From so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful and most wonderful, have been and are being evolved. Everybody that walks through the Hall of Evolution sees this large, this is a panel that is probably 20 feet wide, 8 or 9 feet tall panel lit up. You can't miss it. Like, you can't miss this picture. Challenging the Lord's word and his authority as it shows his creation right in front of everybody that walks through that hall. I couldn't help but take a picture of it. I mean, I just stood there going, okay, this is going to be fun. The origin of species. A lot of us don't know the subtitle of this book. On the origin of species by means of natural selection or the preservation of favored races in the struggle for life. I had an evolutionist come up to me and go, well, now that's like races of all kinds of organisms. He wasn't talking about races of people. Oh, yes, he was. Why can I say that so boldly? Just read Descent of Man. Just read like most of the rest of his works. Guess what? He was a rabid also. He was a rabid racist. Yeah, most people don't know that. And yet we have people all around the world that are like, Darwin was sweet. We have churches. Woo! Hacks me off just thinking about it. Churches celebrating his birthday every year. Don't even, oh. Darwin Day in churches. Like that doesn't even remotely compute in my worldview or my brain. He was a lost man. Even one of the most well-known evolutionary biologists from Harvard said this about this idea of human evolution. Biological arguments for racism have been common before 1859. That's the Origin of Species publication date. But they increased by orders of magnitude following acceptance of evolutionary theory. Why can one of the most prolifically followed biological evolutionists on the planet, why could he say that? Because the idea in an evolutionary worldview of how you and I got here is that somewhere back in history, there's a common ancestor that we share with primates. Now listen closely. Stay focused. Stay with me. If you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ in here tonight, please quit saying what I'm about to say to you with your friends, your evolutionary friends. Well, if evolution's true and we came from monkeys, how come we still have monkeys? Please get rid of that statement in your worldview. Don't ever share that again with an evolutionist, because that's not what they believe, and they will laugh at you. They do not believe that that monkeys turned into. That is not what their belief is. That is not what evolution says. Evolution says we share from a common ancestor with all primates. That is a big difference. Let me explain the difference. Monkeys, primates, through history. And then this is what your statement that you're trying to argue with your evolutionary friend is saying. That all monkeys turned into us. That this is what you have in your brain that evolution says. That is not what evolution says. Evolution says that all the primate line is here, and we branched off of the primate line into the human line over here with a common ancestor, aka still a missing link. Do you understand the difference of what I'm trying to say to you? Evolutionists do not believe that primates turned into us. They believe that primates branched off from a common ancestor. Who's heard the common ancestor? That's what the That means there was this organism down here, this hominin, that the ape split off of over here, and then we went this way. Less hair, bigger brain, over here, walking upright. You understand? So please get rid of the statement with your evolutionary friends. If we came from monkeys, how come we? Because they're laughing at you, and you don't understand why. I'm trying to impact your worldview while I'm here. Please understand, if you have in your worldview, or your friends have in their worldview, that this evolution thing is a done deal. That there's some level of proof out there somewhere. That the scientific community all believes in the evolutionary worldview. Guess what? I hate to share this with your friends, but you really do need to share it. Last time I referenced this website was in, what did I put on my slide? October 15th of last year. The website is called descentfromdarwin.org. There's a group out of Seattle called the Discovery Institute. They're a group of PhD level guys that do not agree with biological evolution, Darwinian evolution. They are not Christians. They don't ride with the history that I'm trying to show you is true. They don't even go there. But they're scientists going, we've been looking for years and we got nothing. So this can't be right. Like we've been observing, testing, repeating and repeating and repeating, and we can't verify it. So there's this letter they proposed that you can go download. It's called the Scientific Descent from Darwinism letter. There are in the list that anybody can go get as of October 15th last year, which I'm sure a year later, it's more than that. I should have checked this afternoon. My fault. I forgot I was going to go there tonight. I would have checked it this afternoon. And recounted, there were 1,033 PhD. You cannot sign the letter if you do not have a PhD in a scientific field. If you do not have a PhD as a teaching medical professional, you're not allowed to sign the list. There are over 1,033, as of a year ago, PhD level scientists that have signed their name with their title of who they are and the school that they teach at, saying Darwinian evolution doesn't work. I don't care what Bill Nye says. Now, some of these guys are Christians that are on this list. Some of them are Bible-believing creationists because they got PhDs and all the da-da-da-da-da. So it's pretty easy for them to go, well, yeah, that's no big deal. So please, in your worldview, if you're like, all the scientific community is against my worldview. No, not at all. Mm-mm, no. Go check out the list. I mean, it's got like guys from like, you're not like, this isn't like community college of blah, blah, blah. This is like Harvard's and I mean, we're like, you know, schools. Okay. But see this man thing. Man. Church, you got two choices how we got here. Two choices. Only one of them is right. You got either we're an upright walking animal with a common primate ancestor, or we're designed about 6,000 years ago in the likeness of their creator, which is what this says. We studied it last night. The time frame of what we studied last night, the time frame of chapter 2, chapter 3, is about 6,000 years ago, period. And maybe for some of you that haven't been here the last couple, all day yesterday, you're going, what? 6,000 years? But we got fossils. I know. Just stay with me. You understand how long 6,000 years is? I mean, like, chew on that for 2 seconds. See, try to leave out everything you've ever heard about millions and billions of years for a second that we can't even remotely fathom anyways. I mean, really. I mean, we hear that and we're like, oh, yeah, that's millions. We don't have a clue what that means. Because I want to challenge you that 6,000 years is a crazy long time. I mean, like, that's a long time, guys. How long have we been a nation? What did we just celebrate? 249, 247? I'm so bad with that history. My colleague Ryan, the historian in our ministry, if he's watching that, he's screaming at me right now. Can almost hear you, man. Here, listen. Okay, so 6,000 years. Hey, our history looks like this on a chart. We got those nice little placemats back there. That's what I call them. The placemat timelines, okay? Back on the table. It was me sitting down several years ago as I'm reading through chapter 5 in Genesis, and it like clicked with me that it had never clicked before. These guys are living at the same time. They're not coming after each other. They're living at the same time. So you have Adam up here at the top. It says he lived 930 years and then he died. But at 130 years old in chapter 5, it says he has his son named Seth. So who did he have before Seth in the first 130 years of his life after the garden? He had Cain and Abel. He had other sons and daughters. Obviously had daughters because Cain, after he kills Abel, he gets banished with his wife, who is his sister. Now some of you right now are going, whoa, never connected that dot. What? That just fell off the truck right there. No, think with me. Connect the dot. Adam and Eve are the first two people. Who's Cain and Abel going to marry? Their brother and sister. Mother. Mm. We don't have any record of that. Okay. I'm going to go sister. I'm going to lean on the sister. Pretty sure about that. Because biblically speaking, why do we not do that today? Why do we not marry within what? First or second cousin? What? He told us to stop. It's not because it's just gross. Dude, that's when I'm teaching kids, they're like, because it's sick. It's because in Leviticus, during Moses' time, 1,000 years after what event that covered the entire planet? The flood. 1,000 years after that point in history, the Lord's laying down this law of how we should live. Some really good guidelines. It's not just a bunch of rules. It's like, hello, don't have a toilet in your camp. Go outside of camp, dig a hole, take care of your business. It's in Leviticus. If you've never studied Leviticus, it's a fun book. I mean, there's stuff in there like, no way that covered that. It covered, as I used to say when I used to backpack growing up in Colorado, you learn to go do a biff. A biff is outside of your camp, over somewhere else. You dig a hole, you take care of your business over there. It is biblical. It wasn't like somebody just came up with that like, oh, well, that'd be a nice idea. It's biblical. Yeah, we're also not supposed to be marrying our close relatives because it's biblical. Because who knows the genetic code better than the Creator to go, hey, we've lost a lot of genetic code. And if you keep marrying within your family, you're going to have problems. The recessive genes, by the time we get to 1,000 years after the flood, the recessive genes are beginning to build up. And then they're beginning to come out. And the Lord knows it's not going to be good. So he lays down some nice little rules. It says, by the way, wouldn't do it. Has that stopped all civilizations? No, because we don't like to obey God. We don't like to be accountable to him. Hello? We like doing our own thing. And and so we still have that going on in some. So this history. I mean, if they're on top of each other in this list, I have no reason to think they did not hang out together and know each other. So Adam, all the way down to Noah's father Lamech, he would have known his great, 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 great grandson, I believe, is six. You guys can double check me there, count that. I think it's six. Sixth great grandson. What a testimony not to have a belly button, I think. My weird youth pastor brain. I would have been the grandson going, "Grandpa, let me see your belly." Because I mean, his is the only one. Only one on the planet. What a testimony. I was number one. I was one. Grandma was two. That's a physical testimony to me in my worldview. Yeah, it doesn't say they didn't have one, but I think it's reasonable. Okay? Human evolution. See, human evolution says this history never happened. The human evolutionary worldview says this didn't happen. We didn't start with two. We started with, well, some common ancestor that came up out of what continent? Talk to me. Africa. Why? Why? Do you know why? It's called the cradle of life. You've heard the term. You've seen the National Geographics. Because where are the bulk of our primates at on the planet? Or is a large chunk of primates on the planet that not only are primates, but are ones that we are attributed to being the closest relatives to? Where are they? They're in Africa. Church, listen to me. When it's stated that the evolutionary idea brings on racism, remember Gould and his statement? What skin color predominantly do we find in the middle of Africa? Dark. So the equation was made in the middle 1800s. If you are of darker skin, you are closer to what ancestry? Primate. It was so bad in the United States of America, there was a gentleman brought from Africa and put in the Bronx Zoo on exhibit. Go check your history. My colleague Ryan, that I just spoke of a minute ago, of his understanding of, he's a historian, he has a presentation that will just absolutely just disintegrate an idea of an evolutionary idea being feasible from the racist side of things in history. If you believe that you are an evolutionist, like what we've done on the race side of things should horrify you, should take you away from the evolutionary worldview like faster than anything else. Because that worldview has driven us to do some absolutely insane things and is still to this day, quite honestly. Because we haven't bothered to trust what this book says about our history, to see what this book actually says. So for tonight, here I am again, introduction totally different than... Let's touch on fossil record real fast. Most of us have seen this picture here. Oh, come on. Computer's a little laggy. Who's seen a picture like this? Okay. In the fossil record, here is what we actually find. In the fossil record, we actually only have monkeys, apes, and people. We don't have monkey people. We don't have ape people. In the fossil record, we have primates and we have us. Period. Some of you right now are thinking, but wait, I've heard these names and stuff. Like, I've seen it in textbooks. Like, here's a biology textbook. I've seen these charts. That chart looks like I'm related to who? to apes. You see the chart, see the lines? The lines show that we're connected. Yet none of this has ever been found anywhere. We have these, but we don't have, and we have these. Oh, I'm sorry, everybody out there is like, what is he pointing at? I'm sorry, I got a point in the middle. We have these in the fossil record, and we have these in the fossil record, but we don't have this, and that, and that, and that. If you think that's too old of a textbook, here is one that I took a picture of. This is, hang on, so I can tell you, just a second, I got notes here, so I can always remember this. This is 2015 edition of the Holt McDougall High School Biology textbook. Probably in some of the high schools here in Colorado as well. This was in Oklahoma, but it's not like it's only used in Oklahoma. The chart looks a little different, but it looks pretty much the same, right? Where have they got us? In the middle of all these hominids, in the middle of the primates, and we're all connected here. None of it can be shown. So right near this, here's the front of that textbook. In case you've seen the textbook and you don't know who made it or what year, that's what the front of the high school textbook looks like. So on let's see, what page is it? There it is. 3-6. So a few pages later, after the chart I just showed you, there's this page. There are many fossils of extinct hominids. Here we go. Hominids are classified. Wait, did I? Nope, I didn't. Back up. Okay. Hominids are classified into several groups. Two important groups are the genus Homo and the older genus Australopithecus. Australopithecus just means southern ape. That's all it means. Got it? Everybody with me? What's Australopithecus mean? Southern ape. Now, it might go home and practice the word. I sat in my office for I don't know how long so I can say Australopithecus, okay? So, that doesn't really roll out well, okay? Australopithecus was a long-lived and successful genus, Australopithecus afarensis. Say afarensis. That is a southern ape from the region of Afar in Ethiopia. Okay? Australopithecus afarensis, who lived 3 to 4 million years ago in Africa, because it was found in Ethiopia, okay, is one of the better-known species of early hominids. Although its brain was much smaller than that of a modern human, about the size of a modern-day chimpanzee's brain, Australopithecus afarensis had very human-like limbs. Who's heard of Lucy? Australopithecus afarensis, Lucy. Comes on the scene in 1974. With much fanfare, from what I've been told and studied, because I was only 3, Donald Johansson finds this skeleton. How much of the Lucy do we actually have? Look at the picture. How much of Lucy? I haven't been in a long time to the Science Center here in Denver. It used to be called the Natural History Museum. Now it's the Science Center, right? Science Center? I cannot recall if there's a Lucy on display or not. Anybody been there recently? Do we have a Lucy on display here in Denver? No. Wow, that's actually shocking to me. Most natural history museums you go into, guess what's on display? Lucy, okay? Replica, obviously, because we only got one set, right? About 20% of the skeleton is all that they found. Since 1974, there have been upwards of 400 different pieces found that have been attributed to this species, afarensis. You ought to see the table laid out sometime. I should show you that picture sometime of all the pieces. So Donald Johansson said this, the finder of Lucy, "I was trying to jam evidence of data into a pattern that would support conclusions about fossils, which on closer inspection, the fossils themselves would not sustain." See, he went into it with a worldview. Did you know that? Everybody has a worldview. He went into the worldview, going to Ethiopia in Africa, And he went going in, believing he was going to find our common ancestor that would have first walked upright like us. That was his worldview going into it. That's what he believed. So when he's picking around this area in Ethiopia, in the region of Afar, he comes across this group of bones scattered over a 50, I think it was a 50 square foot area. They sifted over 20 tons of debris and stuff. They're sifters. Finding, as they're sorting through 20 tons of stuff, they find those pieces and attribute them all to the same creature. But see, he's stating this in a book in 1981, and he's saying, listen, I was trying to jam it. See, I had this idea that what I was finding, that the evidence was going to show me from the skeleton that they walked upright and it was just like us. And guess what wasn't working out as he finds these pieces and parts? It's not working out. This thing would not have walked upright. But he continues in his book, it is hard now for me to admit how tangled in the thicket I was, but the thing about bias, amen, is that it does make one deaf to the cries of other evidence. It almost sounds like he gave up on Lucy. Listen very closely. He never gave up on Lucy. Not to this day. He fights for Lucy tooth and nail. And as of 2015, he's fighting even heavier and harder, according to some things I've just started reading and studying, and I haven't done enough research to show you it yet. So I need to make sure it's right first before I show it to you. Looking pretty good. There are secular evolutionary paleoanthropologists that are going, all that stuff that makes up Lucy, all of this stuff here, as Tim White wrote in Afarensis, almost certainly did not walk like us. They're now beginning to state this is a group of bones that don't go to one specimen. They're from either chimps and apes and or humans. And they've been put together. It's not a bunch of Bible-believing creationists saying that. That's a bunch of secular evolutionists saying that about Lucy. And it's in our museums. You think it's not? Field Museum, Chicago. A year and a half ago. Meet Lucy. So what's right next to it? All those little bones. See, her brain wasn't big enough to be human. It was very chimp-like. Remember that in the textbook? her arm bones, what we have in limbs, they fit much closer, actually, to apes than they do us. Some of the bones that were supposed to have helped us with Lucy was, everybody do this with your finger real quick. Our bones, our metatarsals, I think I got that right, metatarsals, in between our joints, they're flat. Guess what they are on primates? They're curved. They're curved in between their joints. Now, why would that maybe be? Got any wild ideas what that could be useful for? What do they spend the bulk of their time? Spend a lot of their time in grasping things in trees. Their shoulder blades are designed totally different than ours, so that they can hang like this for hours and be okay about it. There are a few folks, I would argue, on the planet, and I've never studied this. It's one of those things I've been like, I wonder if they've got some kind of mutation in their shoulder blade and stuff. Some of these phenomenal mountain climber guys that will spend hours doing this, I wonder if the shape of, I've always wanted to do this study, I wonder if their shape of that, if there's been a mutation in their birth, in their anatomy, that makes it closer to the design of a chimpanzee, just because of some kind of, that allows them to do that for hours and hang from a rock like this. This is one of those curious things that I'd like to know, you know? Like, because we can't normally do that. It's not how we were designed. It's not what we were designed to do. They were designed to do that. And their hands show that. Their feet show that. They don't have feet. They have hands on their feet. Right? Everything about Lucy was very chimp-like, except the kneecap, Donald Johansson said. The kneecap was very human-like. Please understand, when you go back and you study, they found the kneecap down the hill 150 feet from the rest of the material. It's this little... wait, hang on. Field Museum. Can you see it? Kneecap. That was not found with the rest of those pieces and parts. Down the hill, over 150 feet away, down in layers of rock, further deeper than where... What should be the first question that anybody asks? How on earth do we know that that kneecap... Now, see, not being an anatomist myself, I look at that and go, how do you know that's a kneecap? Well, I'm like, what? Okay, but I'll go with, okay, they know what a kneecap looks like. But how do you know that kneecap way over there goes with all of these pieces and parts over here that we're now quite possibly being told probably are from different things anyways. But that's okay. So the kneecap was driving Donald Johansson that it was a human ancestor. But see, the biggest driving force that it wasn't is the hips, the pelvis. The pelvis flares out. Primates' pelvises flare out. Ours curve in. Here, let me show you one of ours. Because right next to Lucy at the Field Museum is one of us. Notice the difference. You see the difference. One goes out, one flares in. The flaring in is really, really important with the way our leg muscles attach to our hips. It allows us to do what? Walk upright. Now, we've all seen the videos of the gorillas that are cruising around. I think it was the Nashville Zoo that made the YouTube. It was like, and he was like, hey, how you doing? He's just like, he's like walking. He was standing up. He's just like cruising around the zoo. But he wasn't walking just like we do. They do more of this swinging thing, like they've been on the horse all day. Because their hip bones are designed, they're designed to be quadrupeds, to walk on the knuckles. Their arms are longer, so they reach further down, so it's easier. They don't have to hunch over as far. I mean, they're designed to do what they're designed to do, and they're great at it. Because they had a great creator. Knew what they needed to live in the environment they live in. And see, sometimes the evidence doesn't always support a worldview. So there are times that the evidence sometimes just needs our help. In 1994, Origins of Human special on PBS, a Dr. Owen Lovejoy decided he could help Lucy. Please watch and listen closely.
The ape that stood up, it was a revolutionary idea. We needed Owen Lovejoy's expertise again, because the evidence wasn't quite adding up. The knee looked human, but the shape of her hip didn't. Superficially, her hip resembled a chimpanzee's, which meant that Lucy couldn't possibly have walked like a modern human. But Lovejoy noticed something odd about the way the bones had been fossilized.
When I put the two parts of the pelvis together that we had, this part of the pelvis has pressed so hard and so completely into this one that it caused it to be broken into a series of individual pieces which were then fused together in later fossilization.
After Lucy died, some of her bones lying in the mud must have been crushed or broken, perhaps by animals browsing at the lakeshore.
This has caused the two bones, in fact, to fit together so well that they're in an anatomically impossible position.
The perfect fit was an illusion that made Lucy's hip bones seem to flare out like a chimp's. But all was not lost. Lovejoy decided he could restore the pelvis to its natural shape. He didn't want to tamper with the original, so he made a copy in plaster. He cut the damaged pieces out and put them back together the way they were before Lucy died. It was a tricky job, but after taking the kink out of the pelvis, it all fit together perfectly, like a three-dimensional jigsaw puzzle. As a result, the angle of the hip looks nothing like a chip's, but a lot like ours.
You understand that ceased leaving science a long time ago. I mean, that's worldview. That's an evolutionary worldview just driven to its furthest point. Don't care what the data says. Don't care what the data is. Don't care what the observable data is. The observable data, man, it looks like a chimp's hip, but we know that's not right. It was a tricky job. I mean, that's like my favorite line in the whole. It was a tricky job. But when you put it together, it's a miracle. I make light of it a lot. If it wasn't so sad. Because I think of how many people saw that. And I'm here to tell you, that is very, very hard to find that video. Like, to find the VHS tapes of that, they're going for like $80 and $90 on Amazon, used. You know what that tells me? I wonder how many of them have been destroyed. Because that's not good science. And I know they know that. Like, I know they know. Like, that is the, that, whew. I mean, I don't have to do much. I don't even have to say much about that, right? I mean, hello? And that's like, everybody I've ever showed that to is like, oh, I can't believe it. I can't believe he's just, wah! Thankfully, he made a replica of it. And then, okay, so I can't, listen. I know I shared last night that I was going to go through all of these, like Artie. Have you heard of Artie? Ardipithecus ramidus? Another one of those guys that's supposed to be on our family tree. Guess what it more closely resembles? An ape. An extinct ape. 125 bone fragments. By the way, same problem that Lucy had. 125 bone fragments had to be chosen from 230 broken pieces in the same fossil bed from an estimated 35 ramidus individuals plus 50 birds and mammal skeletons also in the same bed. So this is what came out of the fossil bed, and they chose the ones in the middle that those are all from one thing. That's their best evidence to date of our closest ancestor. And from those bones, do you see the head? Hang on. Take a close look here. We have the lower bulk of the lower jaw. A little bit of upper jaw area, a skull cap, back of the skull, bottom back of the skull cap, part of the right side of the jaw, left side of the jaw. From those pieces that you see on the screen, this is what was put on the front of National Geographic in 2015. Homo naledi, a strange human-like species, with a mix of modern and primitive features, a.k.a. human-looking pieces and ape-looking pieces. That's the primitive part, is the ape-looking pieces. Oh, I should show you the video of them putting him together, too, but I don't have time. You can Google it. Okay, I'm going to show you part of it.
In the very beginning, this was such a fascinating ancestor to work on. Because it's such a weird combination of primitive and more human-like traits.
it's such a mixture.
You start with a skull, and certain measurements on that skull tell you some things about the soft tissue of the face. The ears are a boondoggle, really, for people like me who reconstruct heads, because there's not much information the skull can tell you about the form of the ears.
Guess how much information there really is. Zero.
Okay. Spine, right at the base of the nasal opening. that projects out of the nasal cavity. And that tells you that there is at least somewhat of a projecting nose, and that's a human characteristic. And skin color is a problem I obviously have to deal with. When I'm thinking about the skin color that should be appropriate for a specific prehistoric hominid, I look to the populations that are living there today. In this case, I'm dealing with a farm that lived in South Africa, so the
what is he connecting?
Were a good model for me to base the idea of skin color on.
He's connecting those, the skin color in that area
yeah,
now,
the hair,
being the exact same as this guy.
So I'm making a guess there. I'm using commonalities in the hair pattern and faces that you see in great apes and humans. It's a wonderful thing to be in the position of being the guy who figures out what some ancient species that's never been found before look like. So the final form of a reconstruction of a face is often a surprise to me. It's the cumulative result of all these individual anatomical decisions, but it has this big ta-da moment at the end of the reconstruction, which is almost like the end of a mystery story where an identity is revealed. And that's an exciting moment for me to have that often surprising moment of seeing the face in entirety for the first time.
Why would it be a surprise if you planned it and made all the decisions about what he was going to look like? Zero data on ears, zero data on hairline, zero data on skin color, zero data on what the eyes should look like. Listen to me. Start paying attention when you start seeing these things, when they do the artist stuff for him. Look at the eyeballs on him. Okay, look at your neighbor's eyes right quick in case you haven't forgotten, if you've forgotten what a human eyeball looks like. What do you see on a human eyeball besides the colored part? The white. Besides the pupil, we see the white. Guess what we don't see in primates? Go, well, next time you're at the zoo, focus on primates' eyeballs. Guess what we do not see in the animal kingdom by and large? In the animal kingdom eyeball, we don't see the whites. They have to look way one way or the other before you ever see it. Go home, check your puppy dog. Check your kitty cat. The whites of an eye is a very human trait. And every one of these guys that they keep putting on our family tree that are mostly ape-like, everything about them says ape. So guess what they most likely are? Pieces of ape. Every one of them, they always put human eyeballs. How much of that skeleton showed them what kind of eyeballs put in there? But it makes him look more like he's like, Like he's getting ready to stroke that wonderful beard. Just one of those little tidbits. File that away. Keep track of that when you go to natural history museums. Neanderthals. Who's heard of Neanderthal? What's your first thought when you hear Neanderthal? Cavemen. Why? Where did they find the first pieces of Neanderthal? In caves. Just because we find the pieces of some skulls and full skeletons, very complete skeletons, way more complete than the last two I've shared, brain capacity larger than ours, everything about them screams human because they were human. They're us living in a cave post-flood. Most likely, the first pieces and parts and skeletons of these guys that were found, they were found in a region where the ice age following the flood would have been happening. And if you do not have the large trees to make your home out of, where are you in all of your brilliance if you see a hole in the ground live? Let me just, what's your best guess, church? I mean, if you got nowhere else to live and you've just migrated from this tower, you're speaking a language that you didn't speak last week. And you see caves, where are you going to live? Does that make you dumb? Does that mean automatically you have no communicating ability other than, just because you live in a cave? See, I'm trying to break down stereotypes. Because we've all heard that caveman idea, right? And we picture them how? Extra hairy, right? Hunched over, right? There's a book we don't carry anymore about an orthodontist. He was doing studies on Neanderthals, and he got special permission to go to France and to study the juveniles that have been found of the Neanderthals. Their skeletons, to study their teeth. He was trying to study teeth differences in humans. And he said, well, I'm going to go study the Neanderthals as well. And he's studying the Neanderthals, and he got permission to get special x-rays and everything and all that. And then he realized from an orthodontic point of view, from a teeth point of view, as he's studying all of these teeth, the real one, the actual ones that he had seen pictures of in textbooks and all the da-da-da, as he's studying, he's looking at them, and he's putting the jaw where we would always put the lower jaw on a human skull, and he's noticing none of them have a protruding lower jaw when you put them in the right place. And he's going back and he's checking his textbooks, and he's seeing the exact specimen that he's holding in his hand, putting the jaw on right, he has a picture in a textbook with a protruding jaw that they didn't put on right for the picture in the textbook. The book's an interesting book because then it literally reads like a Jason Bourne novel. Him getting out of France with x-rays that he had taken, that they required him to give every copy of the x-rays that he took to them. Church, listen to me. There's a worldview out there that does not want you to believe and trust what this book says. And there have been things done. Not every time. Listen to me. Not every time. Not every paleoanthropologist is out to destroy this book. I know that. But I'm here to tell you, this book is right. Why do I know that? Let me share you. Let's go through some. I'm done. Okay, there's a lot of other guys. Like, I could go through this whole. Oh, yeah, here. Neanderthal. You know, we got these pictures in our head of what they used to look like, right? The new models now being done. This is what the new models all look like. Well, what does she look like? Looks like somebody down the street from us, right? I mean, they were humans, period. They've been found in Europe. They've been found in Asia. They've been found in the Middle East. They've been found in Russia. They've been found in, I just lost it. There's one other place that they've been found. They're people. They're post-Babel people. I could go through this whole little chart. You guys have all seen these charts. They show up about every couple of years in National Geographic. They're supposed to be all of our lineage. So there's Lucy here. This is her little line on the family tree. I can seriously on this chart go through every one of these and show you in secular journals, there are people that do not believe they should be on our tree. In secular journals. They're either primates and monkeys, apes, or they're people. They're not monkey people. They're not part of our ancestry. So when you hear one come up in the nightly news, when they find the next new head, please go find the original scientific paper. Don't trust what the news interpreter has interpreted that paper. And then wait. Listen to me. Wait 6 months. Go back and look for the peer-reviewed journals articles of the same specimen. Make sure they're still agreeing with what the first thought was. 9 times out of 10, after peer review, they get marked off our ancestry. And that's why you never hear about them again. Then they don't show up in our museums, and they don't, because we know they're not part of us. Genetics. Oh, nope, 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 nope. Stop, 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 nope. Don't have time. Genetics, let me show you just a few genetic things, right? So we're supposed to be 90-some percent Field Museum says this. A modern study shows that at least 95% of chimpanzee genome is identical to the human genome. Field Museum teaches us this. Well, the issue is, though, and that was 2 years ago in the Field Museum, but actually in 2012, in the national proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, which that's pretty much the largest We Hate the Creationists on the Planet group, they said in their meeting, they showed, it is now clear that the genetic differences between chimpanzees, humans and chimpanzees are far more extensive than previously thought. Their genomes are not 98 or 99% identical. Guess who's not listening to their own stuff? That stuff burns me. And that just ticks me off. Because the scientific community knows better. They've done the research. They know our genome is not 90-some percent the same. It actually, when you do the entire study of the genome-wide, it's closer to maybe 70 to 80%. I've actually went and talked to Dr. Tompkins there that was quoted at 70% just recently in his office. And I said, are we still leaning towards the 70? He goes, now we're now leaning. We're closer to about, we're somewhere around 80%. And some of you may be like, 80% of genomes the same? Seriously? Well, now let's think about this a second. Do all primates have eyeballs? Like, they have eyeballs like we have eyeballs, and they have noses and ears and hair and heads and backbones and legs and arms, and right? If you were the creator, would you have to use a totally different framework and design to create a different creature that's going to live in the same environment called Earth? Would you have to use a whole new genome, totally different than every other thing on the planet? You wouldn't have to do that. And it doesn't show common ancestry as much as it shows a common designer. You can look at that data, the scientific data, the exact same. I mean, we look at the same data. It's about your worldview, how you want to interpret it. It shows me we have a common designer that went, well, there's no reason to totally change up the whole thing. I mean, they've all got to breathe air, so let's give them noses. They got to eat, so let's give them a mouth, and let's put some teeth in there. And so genome-wide, I'm okay with it. But it's not the 90-some that we're fed all the time in museums and in zoos and in textbooks. It is not that close. Not. So a few years ago, Newsweek magazine put out an article, "The Search for Adam and Eve." Scientists explore a controversial theory about man's origins. Controversial. So in the Newsweek article, it says this. Trained in molecular biology, they looked at an international assortment of genes and picked up a trail of DNA that led them to a single individual woman from whom we are all descended. Really? No, wait. What did we read earlier in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 20? Adam names his wife Eve because she's what? Going to be the mother of all the living. I did not need a trained molecular biologist to tell me that we all came from Eve. By the way, they called her mitochondrial Eve. It's a good name. Because they're right. We can take mitochondrial DNA and we can trace all of our mitochondrial DNA can be traced back to one moment. The data says we've come from one woman. See, mitochondrial DNA, in case you haven't studied all that, we all have it. Every one of our cells, trillions and trillions of cells, all of our cells have a mitochondrial DNA. We get our mitochondrial DNA from our mother. We don't get our dad's. So, gentlemen, we have our mom's mitochondrial DNA. Ladies, you have your moms and you pass it on to all your kids. All your kids have yours. That's how we were able to trace it back. That's how that works. It takes out the fathers. The fathers is not there. It's only mothers that can be traced back. Now listen, they've done the same thing with Y chromosomal Adam is what he's called. Done the same thing. We've all come from one man also. Guess how problematic that becomes for that common ancestor thing in Africa? Because now you don't have just a group of things becoming human. You have to have them become a man and a woman from the genetic side. Guess who you never see studies together from the genetic side and the paleoanthropology side, the guys finding the heads, because their stories don't work. Like, it's like, no. And don't get me wrong, somebody's going to go, someday. Okay, so in 1988, they find that we've all come from one woman. And 10 years later, in 1998, okay, so let's read this together. Okay, I'm getting close to being done. Regardless of the cause, evolutionists are most concerned about the effect of a faster mutation rate. For example, researchers have calculated that mitochondrial Eve, the woman whose mitochondrial DNA was ancestral to that in all living people, lived 100,000 to 200,000 years ago in where? Guess what the mitochondrial DNA does not say? It doesn't give us a continent. It does not give us a continent. It just says we came from one woman. And because we see the mutations, every time we have kids, we're losing information. Every generation is losing information. So they had this idea that, okay, if the mutations stick, because God wonderfully designed our genome to fix itself when we lose information. We have copies of stuff to recopy and fix all the bad parts. Except for every so many generations, it gets stuck, that mutation. And it doesn't get fixed. And so it works like a clock. And they said, well, if it's happening every 600 generations, that would put a date of mitochondrial Eve of 100,000 to 200,000 years ago. That's how they came up with that date. They're like, well, let's make an assumption that the generations had maybe every 600 generations, somewhere right around there. But in this study in 1998, they're looking at the mutation rate. And they go, but what if it's faster? Like, it sure looks like it's faster than 600 and some generations. When they put in what it actually looks like, using the new clock, she would be a mere What's our genome genetics say about when mitochondrial Eve lived according to the genes? I would love to tell you this was a biblical creationist that came up with this, and then you know the evolutionary crowd can just blow it off really easily, right? Like, oh, they're just a bunch of Bible believers. Because wait. When was it again that the history in this book says that Adam and Eve lived from us tonight in this place? 6,000 years ago. Guess what? Observing, testing, repeating, and falsifying supports in science. That Eve was legit, real person, lived on the planet that we've all come from 6,000 years ago, according to all of our mutations, that started with sin. Started as soon as sin entered the world. Our mutations began. We began degrading. The history is right. Can I give you one more example? I got to give you one more. Oh, wait. Oh, yeah. This is newer research in 18. The most massive genetic study published in a journal, Human Evolution, they looked at over, if memory serves right, somebody can go check it. Over 500,000 different species of things, genomes. Across the animal kingdom, human, all, everybody. They discovered that virtually 90% of all animals, from the genetic point of view, on Earth appeared at around the same time. Our genetics in the entire animal kingdom looks like they all showed up at the same time. Really? I got an idea of when that was. I mean, I would love to tell them. I got an idea. They're not going to buy it. But more specifically, they found that 9 out of 10 animal species on the planet came into being at the same time as humans did. What's the date they're still trying to stick to? The data said all the way back in 98, when did we show up genetically? 6,000 years ago. But you read the little the afterthought there on the last slide, right? Nobody thinks that's the case, right? I do. I don't have any problem with that whatsoever. Now we're looking at the entire genetic code, and we're seeing it all looks like it shows up at the same time, a.k.a. it couldn't have what? Evolved. Or it looks totally different. What happened at the Tower of Babel? We were separated by language, right? I mean, we get people groups. We get people groups, ethnicities, because of the Tower of Babel. Why can I say that? We're separated by language, and then as we separate across the world, then our genetics by language goes with us. Within a people group, because of that language, all the genetics of them begin having babies, not the entire population together. So within certain regions, by language, certain characteristics become dominant. Blonde hair, blue eyes. Dark hair, dark skin. Olive brown skin. Whatever the characteristic is. Around the world. Predominantly around the world in these regions here. Equatorial regions, predominantly around the world. What colors of skin do we predominantly find? Dominant. Dark. Anybody have any idea why, scientifically, that could be possible? Because it's so hot there and the sun is so intense in those regions that those of you in here, my brothers and sisters that are darker skinned, your skin has the ability to protect you from the harsh rays better than my wimpy white skin does. I burn like a crispy critter. AKA, I'm not going to live as long, thrive as best as those that would have darker skin to pass their genes on longer within a population. So guess who in a population, be it separated by language, would disappear first? What characteristic around the equator? Anybody that would have had lighter skin that went with that language group. They either moved because they were frying every year and got tired of it because they didn't have sunscreen yet. They either moved or they died quicker and their genes don't get passed on. Are you with me? Wait, what's happening oppositely up here? What's happening oppositely up there? We find predominantly what colors of melanin? Lighter melanin. You know why? Because the opposite thing happens. The sun is less intense, but we need the sun to get vitamin D through our skin. But if our skin is darker and it's reflecting that light more, we're not getting the vitamin D we need because the light's not as intense. So guess what? The opposite thing happens at northern latitudes. Predominantly lighter skin, less dark skin. Tower of Babel can explain why we look different around the world. By language separation, not because of skin separation, not because of melanin. By language, we were separated. And then characteristics become dominant. Hello? How many have ever heard that before right now? There's like a handful of you. That bears out with the genetics. Look at the screen real quick. This is mitochondrial DNA research. Mitochondrial DNA research says we have all come from three women also, not just one, three. L3, N, and M. How many ladies do we have in the biblical record that everybody came from after the flood. How many sons did Noah have? Shem, Ham, Japheth. They were married to how many? Each of them had a wife. Three. L3 is most likely Ham's wife. N is Japheth's wife. M is most likely Shem's wife. Now notice where the arrows come from. Where do the arrows always start in our genetics? Where do they always get placed? In the middle of Africa. But wait, they also all run through what area of the world? Where was the Tower of Babel placed that we all came from, biblically? In the Middle East. So would it be just as reasonable to go, well, let's take the L3 arrow and take it this direction instead of coming from? Are you with me? It's worldview that we all started in Africa, not biblical worldview. But L3 could have just as easily come from the middle part and went down into Africa. Are you with me? So the chart doesn't change. It shows a biblical understanding. Just starts in a different place. Doesn't change the chart. Literally, it doesn't change the chart. We find L3 predominant mitochondrial DNA in an African population. We predominantly believe that Ham settled that area, him and his descendants. Japheth went north and up through Europe. Why would we say that? Because the nobles in royal families in Ireland who had to keep track of their royal blood, at the bottom of their royal blood, they had Japheth. Don't tell me they didn't keep track of the royal blood. They didn't know where they came from. That was a big deal. Japheth. The biblical Japheth is at the bottom of their family tree. So, maybe language would prove that evolution is true. So there's this guy. Everybody okay? Stand up, stretch real quick. Before I give you this last kind of piece, and then we're going to... I an hour and a half. Holy moly. That's crazy. Okay. So there's this evolutionist linguistic study fella. Likes to study languages. And he sets out with his evolutionary worldview. He says, you know what? My language studies. We should be able to prove evolution right and be done with this other idea because of language. So his hypothesis is this. If evolutionary history of the human species is right and we came out of Africa, we should have come from how many languages? One. I mean, it should cease to reason. If we evolved from a common ancestor, we started with one language and then all languages have evolved from that one language. That's the hypothesis. That was his hypothesis. That was his study. So he began tracing the lineage of every language around the world, over 2,000 some languages. And to his frustration, cannot get it back to one language. Cannot get all languages back to one language. At last I studied, we can get them down to about 16. Family groups, we call them family, they even call them family groups. That's kind of interesting here in just one second. I mean, his premise seems logical from an evolutionary worldview. Listen to what he wrote in his paper. Listen to the frustration. He writes in his 2012 paper, you could take a gorilla or a chimpanzee from its troop and plop it down anywhere these species are found and it would know how to communicate. You could repeat this with donkeys and crickets or goldfish and get the same outcome. Do you understand what he's saying? That I had never connected till I read this article. I'm sitting in my office one day and I'm reading through this scientific paper and I about fell out of my chair as how obvious this is and I'd never noticed it. What is he saying about languages in the animal kingdom? Every created kind speaks the same language. Like, I'd never connected that dot. Until, like, I was reading this, I think in, like, 2015 was when I was reading this article. And I'm sitting in my office going, oh, my goodness. Duh. Like, every dog speaks the same bark. It doesn't matter if it was born in America or in Mexico. They speak the same bark. Right? It doesn't matter if a Pekingese was born in China. They have the same, they can talk together. Right? Cats all have the same. Every created kind has the same language. I had never connected that dot. And I'm looking at that going, oh. I mean, that was the first thing in this whole article that I went, oh, thank you, Lord, for teaching me that today. But it gets better. This highlights an intriguing, he says, paradox at the heart of human communication. If language evolved to allow us to exchange information, how come most people cannot understand what most other people are saying? Why can I not walk down to this most excellent taco truck and know how to communicate with the man and order a taco? Man, I had those tacos last night. Hello, those are phenomenal. If you haven't had the tacos from the fellow's truck, so I'm trying to communicate with this young lady who's speaking English that's helping me. I'm like, okay, help me with how you say that word, please. I want to know that word. She's saying it, and I'm like trying to repeat it, and I'm just butchering it. Okay, I don't speak the same language. We're all the same created kind, yet we don't have the same language. And he's going, why? Right? And then he says this. The Old Testament story of the Tower of Babel, the myth that tells you what he thinks about the Bible and its history. The myth leads us to an amusing irony that our separate languages exist to prevent us from communicating. The surprise is that this might not be far from the truth. Can't get it to one language. What did the Lord supernaturally do at the Tower of Babel? He supernaturally created languages. We have zero understanding of how many he separated us into. But if we can take them today, all 2,000 some back to roughly 16, when you go to chapter 10 and you start counting the number of grandsons of Noah, guess what lines up pretty close? Huh. Yeah, it doesn't say how he separated us. It doesn't say he separated us by the grandsons of Noah. But maybe he did. And he supernaturally created language. So we will never get it back to the one. That was a judgment against sin. And the science supports it. The observable, testable, repeatable... supports it. Everything we've been talking about tonight supports this history is right about who we are. We were created in his image. That's a whole nother one. Oh, by the way, they're starting to take languages and our genetic profiles, putting them together. Surprise, surprise, there's a relationship between human dispersal and linguistic variation. Wait. Okay. Language, their specific languages connected with specific genetic codes, like we were separated by language at some point in history. These are not Bible guys that are doing these research, okay? Amen. How did he create us? He created us in his image. To have the freedom to worship him. The animal kingdom and the rest of creation worships him out of their great design. We get to worship him as part of our image, acknowledging our Creator and our Savior. We get to love. John says that God is love. We know that love. The animal kingdom does not know that love. Totally different. We We have an understanding of morality because there is absolute truth. The idea of morality, the idea of right and wrong, has zero evolutionary understanding. Evolutionary understanding should say this: if I'm stronger than you, I should be able to take you out and you should be okay with it. Hello? Survival of the fittest. If I'm stronger, I get to survive. If you're stronger, you get to survive, and everybody should be just fine with it. Hitler was trying to do what evolution was not doing fast enough in his worldview. He was eradicating what he thought was the weaker and mutated races, as he would put them, which is very evolutionary. He was an avid studier of Darwin. He very much believed that he could advance the favored race. And he was doing everything in his power to do what evolution was not doing quick enough. Go back and study. It's exactly what he thought. Church, we have one race. It's called the human race. I try very hard. I'm fessing up. That's a work in progress. I try not to use the word race ever when I'm talking about any of us in any of the way we look. Because there's a great genetic study out there that says the differences of the way we look from each other is 0.0812 of a percent in our genome difference. Let me state that again. If you want to know the exact study, I'll go find it for you later if you really, really need that. In our genetic code, the difference that makes up the differences of how we look towards each other is 0.0812 of a percent in our genome. That's how much that matters in our genome. We are making a big deal out of nothing genetically because we're all the same. We're all the same. But see, we've all been taught that we're all different and that we're different races. Racing through life in the survival of the fittest. My brothers and sisters that are darker skinned, we taught in the church. We taught in the church that somehow you're closer to ape ancestry in Africa, so therefore you're savage, you're blah, 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 whatever. It's totally ridiculous. We're still fighting it today because we haven't bothered to see what this book says. We're fighting it today. It just hacks me off. It just kills me. Because we don't bother to see who we are in Him. Whether we're saved or not, it's the only difference. Only difference He sees. Only difference He sees. All of the injustice that is going on is because we've never bothered to study this book. We've taught in our schools for how many generations that we are an advanced animal in an ape ancestry common ancestor. And now we are surprised that we're acting like animals. Hello? And we're surprised we're acting like it. We're surprised when people set up stuff and go, we're going to make our own rules. We don't care what the morality of that group over there says. We're going to do our own thing. Because we have no absolute truth anymore that we all govern by. And we're becoming a zoo. Please understand who you are in Him. That we worship, we love, we have morality, we reason, we are told to do science and scripture, we design things, we create things. It's image, it's about image. We get to serve each other. We get to serve each other. It's all part of our image. The animal kingdom does not share that with us. We are not animals. We did not come from animals, we came from our Creator and Savior Jesus Christ, period. With all of our great and wonderful diversity. Beautiful diversity we have. Lord, tonight in this place, I thank you and I praise you again for your word. But I also thank you that every once in a while, the scientific community will actually share some data that they find and not suppress it, not try to hide it. Because the science always supports your word, Lord. And I thank you that, I thank you for that. We should never be scared of science. We should always be cautious of worldviews. Lord, help each and every one of us in this room to see you differently. Lord, help us to see each other differently. Help us to know and understand we are in this together. Lord, we are yours. We are your image bearers. Help us to see everybody the same with that same image bearing. Lord, help us to treat each other the same. And Lord, oh, help us. Give us the burden for those that are not following you or love you or know you. Give us, please give us the desire to share who you are with them so they know whose image they bear. It's in your Son's name that I pray tonight. My Creator and my Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Did you appreciate that tonight? You didn't get that in your high school biology class, did you? Or your elementary science class? Or any college classes that you took, did you? And yet, isn't there something in all of us that just kind of knows what we've been told all these years just never really added up? And I think even evolutionists, if they're honest with themselves, have all these questions. And they're told by people that they look up to and respect that they're supposed to believe one thing and that that's the thing they're supposed to believe, and they just do what they're told to do. And if they want to be accepted in the larger scientific community for the most part. But the reality is God said what he did. And here's the thing. God was there when he created everyone, and people who evolutionists who put their ideas, they weren't there. We get this beautiful thing that the God who was there loved us enough to actually get it in writing to us. That's pretty cool. And so God knows best. So it's Matt, I want to thank you, brother. Thank you so much for sharing with us tonight. Man, I really appreciate you, bro. Thank you again. And friends, this is what Matt and his wife Teresa and their ministry, Creation Truth Foundation, do. They travel and they teach things to help people see the world from God's view instead of from man's view. And I'm going to be launching a message series starting this Sunday on this idea of worldview that Matt has wet your taste buds with. And I'm going to take you into several key scriptural passages that we'll be looking at over the next month. To really break this down even more in what God says, what it means, and how it applies to us. These whole concepts of viewing the world from God's perspective instead of from man's perspective. When we do that, it starts to make a lot of sense. And God gives us the keys to that in his word. He shows us those things in his word. So don't miss this this next month. These messages that I'm writing right now are going to be very, very helpful to you in grasping more and more of God's perspective and the way you look at the world, the way I look at the world. So I want to say, you know, because this is what they do full time, and they're such a blessing to us. Again, I want to have opportunity to bless them. We do have love offering buckets for them over here and back there and over there. Feel free to give a gift of any amount. Anything that you could give to just bless them would be a blessing. I know some of you have been here several nights and have already given. So please don't feel that you have to give again. But if you haven't had an opportunity to give, please do that. And if God stirs your heart and says, you know what, I'm telling you to give more, then by all means do that. It'll be a blessing to them. So and to what they're doing to spread the truth about what God said, who God is, and what he did, and what he's doing today. Okay, so we want to give you that opportunity as well. Take the opportunity as you leave. Also, they have their table back there with tons of books and resources. And Teresa is a resource expert. That's my sister-in-law back there, and Julie's sister. And so anything that you're curious about that you're like, man, you know, this caught my interest, but I really like to know more about this. Where do I go? She could tell you kind of where to go, what books, what resources, even websites, probably stuff like that. She can give you, she can direct you that way and help you get the information that you're looking for. So, so pretty cool tonight, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Right on. So don't miss tomorrow night. So tomorrow night, 6:30 p.m., same place. And tomorrow night, Matt's going to talk about biblical astronomy. And so Matt's been studying the stars, the universe, the galaxies for years. He's got a massive telescope he's going to bring. We're going to set it up. And once we get finished, as he talks about it tomorrow night, once we get finished, we're going to go outside into the back parking lot. And I'm going to shut all the lights off outside. And we're gonna see what stars and planets and things that he's able to find for us tomorrow night, and he'll be willing to answer your questions as well there. So that's another thing I want to point out. If you have any questions, you're like, man, this stirred something. I'm curious about this. Matt would love to answer your questions. He'll be here for a while afterwards. So just go talk to him and talk to Teresa too. And with all that said, let's close in a brief prayer. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for continuing to teach us and to grow us. In showing us your truth. Jesus, you made the statement that the truth is what sets us free. And we've been bound by lies that we've been taught since we were little in a public education systems. And specifically when it comes to our ancestry and our origins and the origins of the world. Where no man was there to observe it, but you were there because you did it and you told us how you did it. And so, God, we're so thankful for that. And help us to walk in your truth. Help us grow our faith. Make our foundation firm, Lord, as we continue to learn and grow and stand on your word and on you, Jesus, the rock of ages. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. May the Lord bless you all here and those online, and may he fill you all with his peace. God bless.